So the question was, what's going on with data abstraction? And in particular, there was this moment in the lecture when we changed the implementation of the rational enumerant denom functions. Why would we do that? And kind of what happened? Well, I think that this is not a good example of why you would change the implementation of something. This was just meant to show that you could change it. There are other options out there. And if you did change it, some parts of your program wouldn't break. So, I mean, that was kind of the story here, was that we had all this stuff about addition and multiplication implemented already, but it turns out we wouldn't have to change any of that as long as we were careful about calling selectors and constructors the whole time. Then if we did decide to change this to some, you know, weird thing where, I don't know, now it's a dictionary. And so we have to look things up by their key, sorry. Which is like, you know, it seems reasonable you might do this. Then, like, can you still add? And the answer is hopefully yes. What happens when you add 1/2 and 1/6? I'm supposed to get 2/3. Oh, that's some weird warning. Did that make my warning go away? Okay, good. So why would you actually want to change the implementation of something? Well, let's talk about an example. Let's say you had some sentence like the cute dog, and you had decided to represent words in that sentence using data abstraction, which was like, the word for a sentence starting at position 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 and ending at position 5, 6, 7. Well, let's call it 8. Sorry. Start, end. And, you know, we decide, oh, the right relationship representation of this should be like, remember that sentence you're in and the start point and the end point, and then I could make a word out of S going from 4 to 8, and that would represent the word cute. But then later on you might realize, like, oh, over and over again I actually want the text of this, so then I might rewrite this and say, actually how I want to represent the word is just with a string. And then later on, I have a better representation, one that I can print out because I can see it. Okay, so why is one better than the other? Well, actually, in some cases, this representation is better. If you have lots and lots of words, you kind of only want to store the sentence once and then just numbers to remember it for space efficiency reasons. Just like makes your program take up less memory if you're not actually storing the text of the words, you're just storing the whole sentence once, which you had to do anyway, and you're just remembering where within the word it is. So there might be a good reason to have this one. Then there might be a good reason to have this one too, which is like you actually want to be able to print these things out. So, you know, there are cases within programs where you want to change how you represent something. If you weren't using data abstraction, then you'd have to go edit all your code. But if you are using data abstraction, then you kind of don't. You only have to edit the selectors and constructors, and the rest of the program still works. Okay, so yeah, this is like perfect follow-up is, what is this weird implementation of rational? Like, how does it actually work? The story here is that instead of representing the pair ND as a list, you're representing it as a select function. Because kind of any possible way of grouping together these two values will do the trick, whether it's in a dictionary or a list or a function. Turns out functions are perfectly good ways of grouping together values. The way you do it is have a one argument function where depending on what you pass in, you get one or the other of the values. So this is just kind of a trick for defining a function that happens to just represent two values. And the way that it does it is it has to be a function that takes an argument so you know which value you're going to get. And if you're really careful and only ever call it on N or D, these two strings, then you'll only ever get the original N and D values that were passed in. And that's exactly what we do here, is now we're assuming that Numer takes in whatever rational return. Rational return the select function. And like this is always the case between selectors and constructors, is you assume this X is whatever rational return. So we're treating it like a dictionary here because this returned a dictionary. And the other version, we treat this as a function. It better, in fact, be a function. So this return isn't going to work. We need to return some, I mean, it doesn't matter what you call it. We can call it F. But, how about F? But it has to be something that takes in something, some name, and it better respond to these two arguments. Otherwise, you're in trouble. So now we can refer to all this enclosing stuff. So I can compute the numerator in lowest terms. The only reason I define it this way is so that when I call it this way, I actually get out what I wanted to get out, which is the numerator of the original thing that I made. Mm-hmm. So are there cases where you would define some data in terms of a function? Sometimes, you know, functions are useful because they can describe behavior, also because they don't do anything when you define them. So the nice thing about defining data in terms of some function is that you might not actually have to compute the whole sequence or whatever it is. You just have a function that could compute it if it turns out you actually wanted it later. But sometimes in programs, like you generate a bunch of values and then you only use, you know, the biggest one or something like that. So there are actually cases where you do want to represent a value by a function that would compute it if it's ever time to compute it, but maybe it's not time yet. So the question was about an example in a lecture that was using min, the built-in function, with a key argument. And I think it looked something like this. Except I don't know the names of many gymnasts, so maybe I'll just call them A, B, and C. So they were like scores for a gymnast. And then there was another gymnast whose name was B, and she had some scores. And I know that an actual gymnastics competition wouldn't have this much variety, but whatever. And then there was a third one, and they had some scores, nines all around. Now we have a list of three items. It happens to be that each element has four things within it, but that's not really important for most list operations. So most operations like len will just tell you how many elements there are. There's three items in there. And the same is with min. So if you ask what's the minimum of these three, it's going to find some way of comparing this list to this list and comparing this list to this list and figuring out which one's smallest. I will tell you what it does, is that the built-in thing is that when they're comparing two lists, it actually just compares their first two elements. So it compares the A to the B and figures out which one's first in the alphabet. Okay, so I still haven't answered your question, but I'm just getting warmed up. Is that min, the built-in function, is going to give you one of the elements from the original list in its entirety. Even when you use key as an argument to control the ordering. So the idea of using key is that, I've done something terribly wrong. Okay, well, we'll use max instead. I wanted to actually have the order change. Okay, so max is just gonna like find the one that's last alphabetically, C. But when you say max gymnasts, and then you provide a function, it has to be a function of one argument. And the argument is going to be each of the elements in the original list that you're trying to find the max of. And the goal of the key function is to compute some value for each element that is going to determine the ordering. So if I want the gymnast, the item with the largest last score, then I have to write an expression that assumes I take in this whole thing, and how do I get out the last score? Well, that's element at index 3. So who had the biggest last score? It was B. And who had the biggest first score? The element at index 1. Well, 9.1 versus 8 versus 9, that would be A. And I think the example from lecture was to sum up all the scores from 1 on. So that is compute this sum, compute this sum, compute this sum. Those numbers are just to determine the ordering. Which one has the biggest sum? I think it's probably this one. We'll find out. Oh no, I'm bad at math. Oh, well, these are tied, I guess. 8, 9, 9.5 versus 9, 9, 9, both give you 27. Okay, so then it just like broke the tie arbitrarily. But it's as if we did the following. We computed this for every element in the list in order to find the biggest value. And then we found the element in the original list that corresponded to that biggest value. All of that happens in one call. And that's just how max works.